all these factors, whether it is faculty asset, whether it is infrastructure, whether it is the glamorous and this golden career of this station PIT, it attracts the students for in this sluggish period of the engineering. And it is my pleasure to inform to all of you that this institute is having sound admission in 2000 for the last many years. And in the last 2 or 3 years, we are having more than 700 admissions in this institute. And we try our best that institute, the students get a lot of knowledge and be placed in the good company. So once again, I congratulate to the organizing committee. Thank you very much.
मैडम तुम्हारा माइक बंद
हेलो
हेलो
नाउ थैंक यू सो मच सर फॉर एड्रेसिंग द ऑडियंस एंड फॉर योर काइंड वर्ड्स नाउ मे आई कॉल अपॉन हेड ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट प्रोफेसर विमल पंचाल सर टू से फ्यू वर्ड्स
गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन प्रेजेंट इन दिस वेबिनार आई प्रोफेसर विमल पंचाल head of CSE department would like to congratulate Professor Utal Mahajan for her enthusiasm in arranging such kind of webinar in the field of machine learning. I would like to welcome our today's expert, Dr. Mahesh Goyani sir. Welcome, sir. Welcome, sir. I request every participant to attend this session sincerely and get the knowledge delivered by the Dr. Mahesh Goyani sir. Now request Professor Utal Mahajan to give the brief introduction about the today's session and our today's expert. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, sir, for the nice introduction of our department. Now moving ahead. Let's move on to the topic and our expert we are having. All of you have ever wondered how self-driving cars are moving or how Netflix recommends the movie which is your favorite or how Amazon recommends the product you like or how particular Google search engine gives the give you the such an accurate result. Right, or even with the works with the speech recognition and works in the smartphone, right? So all this works because of machine learning. Machine learning is behind all these innovations, and it has given so best accuracies than any other approaches, and it has led to the tsunami in the area of machine learning. So now we are having such an amazing speaker with us to explore this topic, Dr. Mahesh Goyani, Assistant Professor from GEC Modasa. I welcome him. He barely needs an introduction, but I am trying to introduce him briefly. Basically, he is a PhD in the area of facial recognition from Charotar University. Beyond the academic fields, he has keen interest in the some creative fields like photography, literature, poetry, painting, paper art, and so many things. The list is so long, we cannot just describe, and it will go on, go on. He is a BA in Gujarati literature, and after that also he has been authoring plenty of books on computer graphics as well as design and analysis of algorithm from various for various universities including GTU. So we are having this amazing personality with us, and we are thank you so much, sir, Mahesh Goyani sir, for being with us, and we welcome you, sir, for this webinar. And being a student of you, I must say you are the we can say one of the best teacher I came across, and I think we are fortunate enough to be with you in this webinar. Please welcome, sir.
Thank you very much. So I'm just sharing my screen. Give me a few moments. Is my screen visible? Can anyone confirm, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. Thanks for the confirmation. First of all, thank you very much to S.N. Patel Institute of Technology for giving me an opportunity to interact with intellectual people like you. Fine. And thank you very much to Professor Rutal Mahajan for such a generous introduction. Today's talk, actually you are also lucky that you are getting such a nice platform to discuss machine learning. Generally, so far the trend was like that machine learning was considered as a subject of PhD or M.Tech. Fine. Nowadays, the universities are introducing this subject as a BE level also, so that you can get exact feel of machine learning and you can utilize it in your corporate career also. So as I guess most of you are very novice to this subject. Okay, you may not be aware about the term machine learning also. I don't know whether you have heard this or not. So I'll try to keep it as low as possible and I'll try to go as deep as possible. So what I'm going to discuss in this session is that first I'll introduce you that why we need machine learning. Or what is the motivation for the machine learning? Why we need data science and all? Right? So once we are clear to the objective, I'll discuss the most important applications of the machine learning, so that you get the focus or you get the idea that where exactly you can apply the machine learning. Even it might help you to choose your projects in the final year, or you can take it as internship projects also. Then I'll discuss various types of machine learning. And under these different types, what kind of problem domains are there and what kind of problems falls under which category that I'll be discussing. And if time permits, I'll try to cover at least one model of the machine learning that is very popular model, which is called logistic regression and which is used for the prediction. Fine. And if it is possible, I'll try to address one clustering problem also, a clustering algorithm also, that is k-means clustering. However, this is just a plan. I don't know how far I can go, but probably this would be the topic of discussion for today's session. So why we need machine learning, or why data science is so much in boom into the market? Fine, there must be some motivation for this. So before I give you the reasons for this, let me read out some popular quotes given by some researchers and mathematicians. The first one says AI is a part of everyone's life and hard to ignore. Okay. Knowingly or unknowingly, artificial intelligence is part of our life. Even you may be using some of the applications of AI, but you may not be knowing that AI is there. Okay, whether AI is present or there. Let me give you a very simple example. If you are using a cell phone, and I probably everybody using this. So if you have a smartphone, it means you are using AI. Yeah. So again, smartphone is not just a simple phone, or it is using just one application of AI. Fine. You might have installed many different applications, and all applications are running different algorithms in background. And I assume that most of you are having a Google Photos or Amazon at least in your smartphone. Fine. So Amazon is also doing lots of type of deep learning and machine learning for boosting the business. Google Photo is also doing lots of image processing and machine learning to organize your photo and so on. So you cannot detach from the AI. Okay, it's integral part of everyone's life nowadays. Information is the oil of the 21st century, and analytics is the combustion engine. Right? So we are surrounded by lots of data. Okay. We are producing lots of tremendous amount of data 24/7. Continuously, and out of this data, if we do some proper analysis, then that could really help us to boost our business. So how it can be done, we'll see few examples of that later on. In the next 10 years, data science and software will do more for medicine than all the biological sciences together. That means whatever inventions are done or whatever contribution has been done by pure medical field or pure biological science since the inception of this medical field, that will be overtaken by the contribution of data science and software in just the next 10 years. So you just imagine how quickly this data science and this machine learning is growing. Fine. And it is not only related to computer science. Many times people think that machine learning means it's related to computer science. But believe me, machine learning is equally applicable in each and every field. And you whether take it biology or genetics or genome or biological science, physics, maybe social study, political analysis, everywhere you can apply machine learning. So don't consider that ML is only useful for the people of computer science. It's equally important to each and every individual. Virtually, there is no industry without data science or AI. If you are running any business online or maybe offline, right, which is generating some data, and if you are not using data science or AI, then believe me, you won't be achieving the optimum benefit of your business. Right? You must apply some AI technique or some machine learning technique to mine the useful information from the data, which you can exploit to get more customers and ultimately to get more profit. There are a lot of applications to discuss in this presentation, but I'll start with few of them which are very popular. Like in this video, people are moving into the market. So this is like a pedestrian tracking. So what you can infer from this is, you can easily track how many people are there in this particular lane. Okay, what is the density of the people, whether it is crowded or not? Is there any unusual activity or not? That is what the main goal of this. If someone is snatching the bag of some lady and if he is running, then obviously speed of that particular rectangle will be very high compared to rest of all. So you can generate an alarm to indicate that something fishy is happening into this lane. Okay, and you can activate the camera so that you can track the person over different lane also. And you must have seen this kind of concepts in a Hollywood movie. The another very interesting application is game playing. Like whatever older games we were playing on computer or mobile phone, they were totally rule-based system. It means the rules were fixed. If ball is at X, Y position, then you have to put your bat at certain X, Y position, X1, Y1 position, right? So those rules were very stringent, very strict. But as AI or machine learning has come into the picture, the rules, machines are also learning from the experience. So as you keep playing the games, the computer is becoming more and more intelligent. Fine. Computer will start thinking just like a human. And that's why it is known as a machine learning. The goal is what? We have to make machine learn like a human. So machine will also think just like a human, and they will learn from the past experience, just like us. Fine. If we are reading something or we are going through some event 4 to 5 times, obviously our experience at that event is increasing. And hence, we will be more confident about the prediction of something. Right? If you look at some object very first time, probably you may not be knowing it. But when you look at it, you may not be able to recognize it next time. But if you look at that object 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, you read about that object many times, you will get a lot of idea about it. And whenever next time that object is presented to you, definitely you will be able to identify it. So humans are learning from the experience. Similarly, we have to make machines to learn from the experience. So that concept can be applied in game playing. This is another very interesting application is vehicle tracking. Right? So you can find out what is the exact density of vehicle in particular road. And according to that, you can transmit a message over radio or FM band, like in this region, traffic is very heavy, so you can take some other route. Right? So that will ultimately save your fuel as well as time. Or another application is that you can have a dynamic timers for the traffic pole. See, nowadays most of the traffic poles are having a fixed timer, maybe 60 second or 120 second or so. So even the traffic density in one direction is very high and the density in other direction is very, very low, the timers will remain on for the same time in both the directions, right? And that is not desirable, as we know. So what can be done? We can install 4 cameras on all 4 different directions. They will be monitoring the density of each road, and depending upon to the density, that can give the control to the traffic light that in this direction it should be on for 20 seconds, in this direction it should be on for 80 seconds, and so on. So that is totally dynamically controlled, and hence you can do better traffic management without any human intervention. One more important application, that is a character recognition. Now this may be OCR or HCR, that is optical character recognition, or handwritten character recognition. So you have to put, or you have to feed image of the character, and the underlying algorithm will identify whether it is 1 or 2, or whether it is A, B, and C, and so on. In USA, this system is actually in practice. This is used in post. So whenever you are sending some courier or some post, so first the image of address is taken, and that image is given to the machine learning algorithm, and that algorithm will actually digitize it. Okay, whatever handwritten address is there, it will be converted into digital form, and appropriate some barcodes are generated, and the envelope is processed. Fine. So there is no need of any manual processing. Address is automatically typeset in computer system. Got it? So that could be one of the application. The another thing is that you can convert the old books, okay, manuscripts of very ancient time when printers were not available. So most of the times people were writing with the ink, right? With the help of that ink. So such manuscript is hard to digitize because there might be of thousands of pages or millions of pages. So it is very hard to typeset. So what you can do is you can design an algorithm for the character recognition. You feed the pages of that manuscript to your application, and that application will simply digitize it. Right? So that will be very fast also, as well as you don't require much human power. The list is very big for this. Let me give you the last application for this. Like, you can use it in automatic number plate recognition also. So at toll booth, generally you observe a very long queue of the vehicles, right? Because that toll collection is a bit of a tedious process, although nowadays there is a FASTag and all. But what you can do is you can install the camera at a toll booth, which will be reading the number plate of the vehicle, and that number plate will be processed using such character recognition algorithm, and it will identify that what is the exact number plate of this particular vehicle. And the RTO database is connected with the bank. It means the bank account of each individual is connected with RTO. So RTO has interface, like the number plate is coming real time from the vehicle, and it has a data set which says that this particular bank account is connected with this number plate. So automatically the fixed amount will be deducted from the account of the driver. Okay, so there is no need of any kind of manual collection and so on. You don't have to wait for a longer time into the queue. So again, this will save a lot of time if it can be installed or implemented successfully. And you can find many lot other applications for character recognition. The another important application is like living portraits you can generate, okay, which seems quite impossible till date. But now it is also possible, as you can see that Mona Lisa is talking or singing. Right? So you can morph such faces on some 3D model, and you can give the instruction or you can write an algorithm so that model will do the lip sync, or it will express the ideas or thoughts in form of these 3D models. You can control the device using the hand gestures, or it can have a lot of other application. Like if you want to open your car lock with only specific gesture only, so you can design the controller like that, that whenever I'm showing a thumb up, the car should be unlocked. Or whenever I am showing a smiley and I'm tilting my face, then only car should be unlocked. So that kind of application you can design, whatever gesture you want to connect with any other activity, that is quite possible. You can do that very well. Fine. So this is quite a small list of applications of AI or the machine learning. There is an entire section for the application I have in this presentation. So you can explore it in much detail, that where you can apply the machine learning or whether you can take any of them as your final year project or what. Fine. This might not be a new term for you, artificial intelligence. We had a traditional approach in which we were writing the straightforward rules to solve the problem. So we were writing the instructions, like if you want to solve a problem of matrix addition, then you required simply two loop for I is equal to 0, I less than n, I plus plus. Inside that, you are putting some another loop for j is equal to 0, j less than n, j plus plus. And inside that, your main logic goes like c of I comma j is equal to a of I comma j plus b of I comma j. Fine. So that's called a traditional or the classical approach for solving the problem, where you are writing a straightforward rules, and then you are giving the data and appropriate output is generated. But there are many problems in real world that cannot be solved using such classical or traditional approach. Many reasons for that. Either it could be untractable, that means you can solve it, but it takes very long time, so that there is no application of solving the problem. For example, you want to unlock your mobile. You forgot the password. You know the thing that password is between A to Z, small letters, A to Z, capital letters, 0 to 9 symbol, and some 10 or 12 special symbol. So that domain knowledge you have, some prior knowledge you have that, okay, my password was some 10 characters, and the possible characters in this is like 26 capital letters, 26 small letters, 10 digit, and some 10 special symbol. So you can definitely unlock your phone by trial and error method. You try one combination of 10 letters, again you try another combination of 10 letters. So definitely at some day you will be able to crack the password. But do you think, is it feasible? Right? Or probably it might take 2 years or 3 years to unlock the password, but there is no application of that. So such problems, or there are certain problems which may not be at all solvable by a traditional approach. So for that, we have a specialized kind of intelligent algorithms, which generates very good results in less amount of time, as well as it is inspired by some nature also. Right? So such set of algorithms are called artificial intelligence. Within that, we have a specialized set of algorithms which are totally based on mathematics. Okay, purely it depends on statistics, probability, linear algebra, various optimization techniques and all. And those algorithms are very, very powerful. And this algorithm or set of algorithm is classified as a machine learning algorithm. Machine learning is actually a part of AI. And within machine learning, there is again a specialized set of algorithms which are totally inspired by human brain, and they are known as a neural networks. Okay, so convolutional neural network, deep neural networks. There are many other models of deep neural networks like AlexNet, GoogleNet, RaiseNet, and many more. I don't know whether you have heard or not. So those algorithms are very, very powerful, and that will free you from extracting the features which we are generally doing in machine learning. I'll talk about what features are and all. So you don't have to do even that in case of deep learning, but such algorithms are computationally very intensive. It requires lots of computational power. Probably you may not be able to process it on your computer. Fine, you required a very standard configuration for that. So those algorithms fall under the category of deep learning. So today I am going to touch upon the middle part of this, that is machine learning. Yeah, so we were talking about the motivation for the data science. Fine, why we required to do analysis of the data, or why this is very much in boom nowadays. So this image is of 2019. This source I have taken from the Twitter, and it's a 2019 image. It describes what is happening in 60 seconds across the globe. Okay. The time measure, you take note of it, this is 60 seconds. So what is happening in just the 1 minute? 41.6 million messages are being sent over Facebook Messenger and WhatsApp. Okay. 4.8 million GIFs have been served by the application Giphy. If you don't know, you can search about it. Okay, so it generates the GIF images. Similarly, 1 million logins are done at every minute on Facebook. Yeah. Similarly, you can see that another very popular social media platform is Instagram. 347,222 scrolls are happening on Instagram. So these are the only few of Netflix, one of your very favorite nowadays, fine. So in just 1 second, 694,444 hours of videos have been watched by all together. Fine, in just 1 second across the entire globe. So these are the only some of the social medias, and you just see that what tremendous amount of data they are generating. Now, if we can wisely exploit this data, that will definitely help us to boost our business. Right? Let me give you one example. And I'm sure all of you must be aware about it. And already Rutal ma'am has given the example that whenever you are searching something on Amazon, so for example, you are searching for some mobile phone, so automatically you are getting some recommendations, and those recommendations will be quite similar to what you are searching. Fine, automatically you will get it. Fine, so probably you may be interested into those recommendations. If you are looking for some book, then automatically you will start notifications, or you will get some advertisement related to book. Even when you are moving from Amazon to some other websites, you will start getting the notifications or the advertisements related to book. So you see that how this search, Google search or any other search, is interconnected with other social websites. Fine. Suppose you want to go to the Mount Abu and you are searching for some hotel, fine, like hotels near Abu. That suppose you have searched for some abc.com website. Now when you will open some def.com website, you will see the advertisement related to hotels in Mount Abu. I'm sure you must have observed this at some stage in your life. Fine. Whenever you are going to some other website, xyz.com, again, you will see the advertisement related to that. Fine. You have not searched anything on xyz.com, but still you are seeing the ads related to hotels in Mount Abu. So this is the recommendation system. This is how the business is increasing. Fine, that automatically the such search engines are mining your queries, and based on your query, they are doing the recommendation. So definitely that will help to get the business up. Fine. So this is just a very small snapshot you can consider. There are thousands of, not thousand, but at least hundreds of different social media platforms are there. Fine, and you combine the data of all. So how much amount of data we are producing every day. And this is the scenario of just a 60 second, right? Fine. So as I said that this image is from 2019. So there was a prediction that by 2020, the digital universe will reach 44 zettabytes of data. Okay, so by at the end of 2020, this entire universe will have 44 zettabytes of data. And one zettabyte means 1 trillion gigabyte. Okay, so totally 44 trillion gigabytes of data is going to be generated at the end of 2020. Okay? So you see that we are simply living in the ocean of data, okay, or the ocean of information. We just need to mine it properly. Yeah. So we have seen the motivation, why we need data science, or why we need to understand or process data wisely. Now I'll take the case why we need machine learning, or where you required machine learning. So the classical programming, as I have discussed, that we are writing some instructions, which are called rules, and we are giving some data as an input. So I assume that I'm writing rule like this: for I is equal to 1. Let me write it down here. For I is equal to 1, I less than or equal to n, I plus plus, and f is equal to f into I. And let me set f is equal to 0. Can anybody predict what will be the output of this code? Look at the code carefully and tell me what will be the output of this code. Either you can enable your mic or you can put your answer in chat box. F is equal to 0 for I is equal to 1 to n, I plus plus, let me set n is equal to 5 for simplicity. Let me go to the chat box if anyone has given the answer. Yeah, exactly. That's zero. Fine. Why it is zero? Because we are initializing this as with zero. Okay, f is equal to zero. Okay, what if I keep this is one? Yeah, all are right. Yeah, Riya, Pavitra, Prerna, Hinal, Ridham, Bharat, all are right. Fine. So I'm assuming that this is the answer of previous case. Now I'm changing f is equal to one. Can you tell me what would be the output? Five factorial, exactly. Fine. So that will be 120. Five into four into. See, this is simply f into I. F is one. So initially that will be one into one. Then that will be one into two. Then that will be 1 into 2 into 3. Next time it will be 1 into 2 into 3 into 4. So answer is 120. Right? So this is the factorial program. So now see what I have written here. This is called rules. Okay, these are the rules. And what is my data? N is equal to 5. So if I change this data, N is equal to 6, then my answer will be 720. Okay, rules are fixed. Only data are changing. If it is 3, then according to output is generated. So in classical programming, we always write some rules. And we are feeding some data, and according to that answer is generated. Fine. So suppose you are a very good programmer and you are able to solve all kind of problems. Okay, you are able to suppose code anything, but still, irrespective of your coding skill, it is not possible to solve all type of problems using classical programming. Let me give you one very simple example. Suppose there is one face recognition system is installed in your classroom or maybe in organization, and it is taking the attendance. Right? So there may be some hardware mechanism, and you have to stand in front of your camera, in front of the camera. That camera will capture your image, and that captured image will be matched with the template or the pre-stored image. So what is initially required? Some sample of your face must be available into the that hardware, so that next time you are coming, some query image is captured, and this query image you have to match with the images stored in the hardware. If match is found, your attendance is marked. If not, then you will be considered as an absent for any particular day. Can I compare pixel by pixel intensity of two images to match the people? Like let me call this as a query image and let me call it as a template image. So can I write a code like this to match the images? For I is equal to one, I less than or equal to number of rows. So I'm indicating as a R. Assume that this image is a R rows and C column, I plus plus. Inside that, I have another for loop. For j is equal to one, j less than or equal to column, j plus plus. And if the I comma j pixel, ith comma j pixel of q and ith comma j pixel of this t are same. So I'm simply doing it. If q of I comma j is same as t of I comma j, okay, and this is true for all, then return true. Okay, anytime if it is false, then we are returning false. That means let me consider if this is true for all the instances, then we'll mark as a present. And if it is false for any single instance, we are marking it as a false or sorry, absent. Will this code work in reality? Can I write such kind of code to compare two images? Is it feasible, or is this approach valid to compare two images of any dimension? Say, for example, both images are of 400 by 400 pixels. What do you think? What's your view on this? Can we compare images like this? You may write down your answer. No, sir. Fine. No. Okay. Fine. So answer is absolutely right. Can anybody tell me the reason for that? At least one reason. There are many. But I'm expecting at least one reason why we cannot compare like this, or why this approach will not work in general. No, but using ML it is possible. That is fine. Yeah, Hinal Mistry, you are correct. but why this classical approach will not work? I need at least one reason for that. Every time background and look will not the same exactly. Fine, rhythm, perfect. See, whenever you are standing in front of camera, there are many parameter which will affect the intensity of these two pixels. So this is fixed. Whatever is stored in your hardware, the intensity of all these pixels are fixed now. Whenever you stand in front of camera on Monday, the lighting conditions would be different under which this image was captured. Another possibility is that your distance from the camera might be different. Third possibility is that background might be different. Because see, whenever you are standing in front of camera, lot of other background things will also be captured, right? So and that will definitely affect the intensity of all these pixels. Your orientation of head may not be identical to this. Okay? Suppose here it was perfect up frontal face, but here there might be some in plane rotation or some out of plane rotation, or you might have grown mustache or beard on your face. So ultimately, the intensity of all pixel will not be same as like this, and hence you cannot write down straightforward rules like this. Right? So classical approach cannot be applied here. As I said, there are multiple rules for that. So machine learning will help us to solve such kind of problems where you cannot write down static rules. Right? So what we are doing in machine learning is we are using the data and we are feeding the answer. Fine. So what we'll do is I'll provide one image of person A. So that is my data. And I'll also provide the label that this image is of Mr. A. So this intensity matrix or the image is my data and corresponding label is my answer. Similarly, I'll provide another image as an input and I'll provide the answer for that, that this is Mr. B. I'll provide another image and I might say that this is Mr. C. Fine. And I'll provide such multiple sets of images, not only one, so that I can capture variability into the face. Fine. If it is slightly tilted or it is taken from some other distance, rotation of head pose may be somewhat different. So I'll use set of images of every person to train the model. So I'm using such bunch of images of Mr. A, bunch of images of Mr. B, and so on. So I'm providing data and answer. And this machine learning algorithm will produce rules. So what is rule exactly? The way you are solving the problem. So here, see, I was writing rule and I was giving the data and it was generating answer. But what is happening in case of machine learning? I'm providing answer. I'm giving the data as an input and this black box is generating the rules for me. Isn't it magical? Fine, automatically it is generating rule. Do you think it's completely automatic? Obviously not. Okay, this is not a magic. You required a lot of mathematics and probability involved here so that you will get some rule so that whenever next time I give input of some person, maybe Mr. A, B, or C on next day. Fine. So what will happen? I already know the rules that image looks like something like this, then I should classify it as a Mr. C. You have not written the rules. You are not comparing them by pixel, but still these rules are such that it will easily find out the correlation or the association between the data and the answer, which we have used to create the machine learning model. Okay. So machine learning model means what? We have to train a machine such that it will establish the relationship between the given data and the answers so that whenever next time we are giving some input query here, it will utilize the past experience, that means the rules, and from those rules or the past experience, it will tell us that whether it is Mr. C or not. Right? So that is very abstract explanation of machine learning. Right? It's very abstract. But this is what happening in this, or what is this difference between classical programming and machine learning is. Okay. Meanwhile, if you have any query, you may ask related to whatever we have discussed so far. The questions which are not related to this session, we can discuss at the end of the session. But if you have anything related to this particular part one, feel free to discuss. Else, we'll move to discuss few applications of machine learning. Is there any query? Anyway, you can put it in chat box whenever you are feeling it okay. Whenever I'll have a look at this chat box, I'll reply them. So let's move forward. Yeah. So we'll discuss few very important applications of machine learning. So one is automatic language translation, right? And this is very popularly used. Like whenever you are going to some other country and you don't know the language of that country, you can always use this kind of translation. So you may be aware about English and you want to generate some French, so that is possible. Or suppose you are fluent with Gujarati language, but you don't know what is the English of particular statement, you can use such kind of translator. And let me see if I can show you appropriate application, actual application of this. Google Translate. And see, I'm writing here something. How are you? So my input language is English. Let me choose some translation of this. Let me select Hindi. You see that? Kya hal hai? Fine. So I have not done anything. I just wrote it then, and it is giving me how it should be converted into Hindi. Let me check what it is giving in Gujarati. Is there? Yeah, Gujarati is here. Tamay kam cho. See. Fine. So this is really very interesting, isn't it? So this is totally based on natural language processing. It is not straightforward rule. Okay, there won't be any kind of mapping. Like in database, there is one statement, how are you? And in front of that, it is written that tamay kam. So it's not like that. Fine. It's totally based on natural language processing, that whatever you are writing here in English, it will be interpreted. Its semantic and syntactical meaning is extracted. And from that, the mapping in Gujarati language is done, appropriate grammatical corrections are done, and the answer is generated. Okay. So this is not just a simple lookup, that if statement is like this, then answer is this. Statement is like this, then answer is this. No, it is not that kind of simple matching. It is quite complex process. Okay, let me write down this here, Gujarati, and let me convert it into some other language. Okay, we don't know Urdu, else we could have tried, but let us try at least Hindi for that. Kya hal hai? So there might be some misclassification or some trade-off in accuracy also. So, but we are not that much worried about it. We got the idea. Fine. So gradually, by experience, this will be corrected. If I'm erasing this, is it possible? Let me check it out. No, that's not possible. But whatever we are searching here, so that Google is also learning in background that what people are frequently searching and whether the meaning of that which is shown here, it is correct or not. And based on that, it is correcting if it is not. Right? So that's very nice application, that is automatic language translation. Another very popular application is a medical field where a tremendous amount of work has been done and that has proved quite vital for human life. This is the section, or you can say that it's a cross section of the, I guess, brain. And here some region, this could be a potential tumor into the brain, fine. So we cannot actually go inside in brain and see whether there is a tumor or not. But obviously we can have CT scan or MRI scan or X-ray of different parts of the body. Okay, and on those images, we can apply the image processing and machine learning. Such that we can get some idea about these images, whether there is a tumor or not. If it is that, then what is the size? What is the seriousness of that? Whether it is in type 1, type 2, or maybe level 1, level 2, level 3 stage. So that kind of analysis we can do. So we can free the doctor from this also. Okay, even doctor do not need to check it out manually. We can write an application which will tell us that this particular part is infected or there is some fracture in this region. Stock market prediction, if you are good at regression, which I'm going to discuss, if you are good at regression, then you can predict a lot of things. You can predict what will be the rain on particular day, fine. So it's something like a jyotishi, fine. You can actually see the future. You can actually predict the future, what is going to happen on next day or after a few days. But for that, you require lots of domain knowledge and you should have a sound understanding of statistics and probabilities, right? So depending upon the past movement of the Sensex points, as well as not only the movement of Sensex, but many other parameters, that what was the economy on USA, what was the economy of China, what is GDP rate of India, how different companies are performing, whether the share of particular company is going up or down. So there could be such hundreds of parameters which is affecting the Sensex value. So if you actually know how it is computed, and if you have the parameter that, okay, yesterday the value of these parameters were this, or today the USA is going to launch some exciting policy, so there are chances of Sensex going up. So based on that, you can design some regression model which will tell you what will be the Sensex value in afternoon or at 3 p.m. or after 2 days. Well, such application you can always write for the prediction of anything. Another very useful application is online fraud detection. So in one day, millions of transactions are happening in a bank, and it is impossible to manually check whether all the transactions are legitimate or not. Okay, most of the transactions are valid, they are legitimate, but there will be few which are not legitimate. Actually, they are fraudulent transactions, but manual inspection is impossible because of the amount of transactions. It comes in millions, right? So what we can do is we can write a machine learning application which will identify some anomaly into the transaction, and it will warn the customer. Let me give you one simple example that will make the things clear. I hope all of you are using some Google Pay or any other payment method, maybe Paytm or maybe online banking and all. Assume that in some geographical region, maybe in Surat or nearby Surat, I am staying, and I am mostly making my payments from Surat only because my business is there. And assume that this is the scenario, and I am doing approximately 1 or 2 transactions per day, or maybe some 20 to 25 transactions per month. And the range of this transaction is mostly, suppose, less than some 15,000. Okay, all the transactions maybe. I may be paying to my, I'm paying my rent, or I'm maybe using it for the recharge or to pay the gas bill and so on. For such purposes, I'm using this app. So most of the transactions are less than 1500, and most of the transactions are done within the fixed geographic region, Surat. Okay, I have never been out of Gujarat. Okay, that's a hypothetical condition I'm talking of. I have never been out of Gujarat. I have rarely been out of Surat. So very few transactions have been done outside of Surat, but again, it's in the range of 15,000. Now, this algorithm is detecting one transaction, which is of amount 2 lakh. It's not totally unacceptable. You can, this is acceptable. Okay, I can do the transaction of 2 lakh. Fine, there is nothing too new in that. But the location detected here is, say, for example, USA. Or maybe Singapore, fine. So machine learning algorithm will see this particular transaction as an outlier in our data set. Okay, so if I plot it, then all my transactions are clustered near 10,000 to 20,000, and they all are at this particular geographic region. All of a sudden, one transaction of 2 lakh has been reported, fine, 2 lakh. So here I'm suppose assuming that this axis is representing amount, and this region, this y-axis is representing some geographical region, and that is noted into the USA. So you see that these all transactions are sitting together, they are tightly coupled, but there is one transaction which is very, very far from my all the transactions. So obviously this would be fraudulent transaction. If not, there are 99% cases it would be that fraudulent transaction, because I have not done transactions outside this particular region, and all my transactions were within this range. Got it? This is called, this is how bank algorithms are detecting the fraudulent transactions. Virtual personal assistant, you may be aware about all this, right? Siri, Alexa, Google Assistant, Cortana, you just speak something and they will help you, whatever help you need. If you are giving the command like Alexa, please search a particular song, or Google, please book my appointment with someone. So, or like a Google, please call this person. So it will automatically call this. So they are totally based on speech recognition and machine learning. Email spam and malware filtering. So nowadays, if you see the interface of the Google, then you would be seeing four different categories like primary. So in that you are getting your main mails, primary section. Then there is a section for a social. Fine. One section is for social. One section is for, I guess, it's update. There is one update section. And the fourth one is, which was that promotion. Okay, promotion. So you see that you are not categorizing your mail in any of this category. So whatever mail is coming to the Google or Gmail, so Gmail will run classification or the clustering algorithm on that. And depending upon to the content in this mail, it will automatically put it into one of the category, maybe social, update, or promotion. And you always have an option to mark it as a spam. So some mail will go to the spam also. Yeah. So this is email spam and non-spam detection. So depending upon to the content of the email, it will determine whether the given mail is spam or not. Okay. So you can write down such kind of applications to classify the content. So Google News is another example of this. Google News is clustering the news based on similarity of the topic. Audience, you are requested to mute your mic, please.
Hello, sir. Please unmute yourself.
Fine, fine. So coordinator has muted me also. Anyway. Yeah, yeah, fine. So I'll discuss this one again. That this is the application of recommendation system. See, if I'm searching something on Amazon, then similar products will be recommended to me. So the title of this book is see, Prediction Machines. Right? And you see that all such book, all these books are very similar to those titles. The titles Applied Artificial Intelligence, Human Plus Machines, and so on. So the buyer may not be knowing that there are some other books like this is also available on the Amazon, or even he may not be knowing such titles do exist. But whenever he see the recommendation, he may be interested in such kind of books. And instead of buying one book, he might ended with buying three books. Yeah. So you see that how this Amazon is growing the business, not just Amazon, all kind of such e-commerce commercial platform. And many times you are seeing the combo also. Right. Let me show you. If I can, and let's search for some DSLR. Let me talk about some camera. So for example, I'm selecting this Canon EOS 1500D. I'm interested in camera. I'm very new user to the camera. Fine, I don't know much about this. I'm just interested in photography and I want to start with something. So whenever I'm searching for this model, and I'm looking the specification and all, you see that frequently bought together. So Amazon is also telling me that the people who are buying this camera, they are often buying this tripod. Now I may not be knowing about the different kind of tripods or what are the different kind of filters are available, but this will help me out that, okay, this is also very useful for the camera. Fine. I may not be knowing about the different accessories, but this is telling me that I should buy this also, as well as I should buy this also, as well as it is giving me lots of other recommendations also. Right? Let me search for some mobile phone. So instead of buying just DSLR, I may end up with buying those supporting equipments also. You see that who is buying this? They are often buying either this or this. Right? So you may be interested in some glass, or you may be interested in some back cover also. Right? So see, originally the price of this was 21,999, approximately 22,000. But instead of that, you will be paying 22,444 at the end, because you may be interested in this. Right? So this is how the machine learning will help you in business using recommendation systems. Yeah. This is traffic prediction. As I said, that some camera can be installed. So I'm just skipping this application. Fine, I have already discussed it, so I'm not wasting the time. Speech recognition, again, you can use it for unlocking your mobile, unlocking your laptop or any other device. Or even you can give your audio to the systems like Siri or maybe to the Alexa, and it will work accordingly. Image recognition, fine. So there are many different such pattern recognition applications exist where you can apply such machine learning application. It may be a face recognition, fingerprint recognition, maybe some object recognition, fine, fruit identification, anything it could be, any kind of pattern you can recognize with the help of machine learning. Automatic language translation, speech recognition. Yeah, let me, that is not exactly speech recognition, but let me show you one very interesting application, and that will be definitely help you in future. Yeah, there is an option called voice typing. Okay, just to see. Hello everyone. Welcome to the workshop on machine learning. I hope all of you are fine. See that whatever I am speaking, it is typing automatically. Fine. Whatever may be the speed of yours, it will automatically interpret it, whatever you are speaking, and it will type all these things. So this might help you to get rid of typing the assignments given by the faculty members, isn't it? You just keep speaking and it will keep typing automatically. So this is really a very amazing applications for all those who want to type their book. Okay, those who want to write articles, what do those who are interested in writing something, they can take benefit of this wonderful tool of the Google. You see that how accurately it is detecting my pronunciations. Fine. So this is completely customized, because see what it will do whenever it is making some mistakes. Now later on, I am going to rectify it. I will correct it out. So you see that there is an icon on right hand side at the top. Fine. This is Google account connected with Mahesh Guyani. That means it is personalized account. So whatever corrections I am doing here, that will be personalized. So whatever corrections I am doing here, fine. So the model will be trained according to that. So the model which is performing for my speech and the model which is performing for your speech would be different. Fine, because your pronunciations may be different. My pronunciations would be different. So basically, whatever corrections I am doing, based on that, it will be personalized, and that will be better and better over the time. Take a look how nicely it has typed. Fine. So this is the. Anyway, let me move ahead. Yeah, let me close that. Otherwise, it will keep typing, I guess. Yeah. Fine. So that was all about the applications of the machine learning. And now I'll talk about various types of machine learning. Let me hide this bar so that would be easy to view. Yeah, fine. Basically, we can classify machine learning algorithm into one of the three major categories. Actually, there are many, but these three are the major one. The first one is called supervised machine learning. In supervised machine learning, what is happening? It learned. So you can compare the machine learning model as a student. So student is a model, fine. Teacher is the data. Teacher is the data, and the answers are the label. Okay, what teacher is answering, that would be label. Now see what is happening. We are giving set of data to the model, and also label we are providing for that. So suppose I want to design an application for animal recognition. So whenever I present an image of animal, that model should tell me whether this is dog or cat or horse or what. So what I'm doing is, as I discussed earlier, I'll give bunch of different images of the cat. So all these images belongs to cat, and I'll assign answer to that. Okay, that is for each image, I'll pass on cat, cat, cat label along with this data. This all images are of, say, for example, dog. So for each image, I will pass the answer also, that this image is of dog, this image is of dog, and so on. Again, I have some set of some another animal. Fine, right now it is cat. So I'll pass on the label cat, 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 cat. That will go to this model. Now this model will learn the association between the data and the label. So what it is doing? It will try to formulate a mathematical model or the mathematical equation, which will tell us that if image looks like this, then label associated with that is cat. If image looks like this, or our data looks like this, then the label associated with it is dog. And if it is something like this, then it is considered as a cat. Now see, you put yourself here, okay, and put myself here. Okay, so I am teaching you, or I am training you. So if your training is good, okay, if you have learned properly, then you will be able to perform well in the test. I'm sure that there will be some test at the end of this session. Fine. So if you have learned properly, you will be able to use your brain to answer those questions. Or let me put it into some another analogy. The student who are regular in the classroom, those who have listened teacher carefully, those who are referring good books, they would be generally perform well in external examination. In external examination, only data would be given to you, questions would be given to you, answers would not be given. Fine. Only you will be asked that write down an algorithm for a selection shot. So during the class,
Dear students, wait for a while. Our speaker is disconnected. He will be connected soon. Dear participants, thank you for your patience. Just wait for a while. Sir is connecting with us once again and continue from where he has left lastly. You may put forward your questions that you have written in the registration form to the sir after this session, or you may write it in the chat box right now also. Okay, sir is again with here us. Now let's continue from that.
Yeah, give me a moment. I am just sharing my screen. Is my screen visible? Can anyone confirm, please?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine, thank you. Yeah, so I guess I was disconnected when I was talking about supervised learning. Am I right?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. I cannot do anything with such kind of unavoidable circumstances, but extremely sorry for that. So what I was telling is that I'll try to give you analogy of child learning in case of supervised, unsupervised, and reinforcement learning. Audience, please mute your mic. Harin. Moderator, please mute everyone. Yeah, fine. He's muted. So what I was saying that, say for example, a parent wants to train a child to recognize an apple. So parent will show one apple and will say that, baby, this is called an apple. Fine. So what a child will think that something which is red and circular in shape, that is probably an apple. So whenever next time parent shows a red ball to the child or the tomato to the child, child may interpret as an apple. What is the reason? Because the training was not done properly. Parent has only shown one apple to the child. So he understand that only the things which looks like this is always an apple. Fine. So next time parents will say that, beta, this is called a tomato, this is called a ball, and parent will show different shapes and different kinds of apple. And every time they will give a label that this is called an apple, this is called an apple. Fine, maybe different in shape, maybe different in size, maybe skin texture of that apple would be different. So the baby will start learning that, okay, even if it is a small in size, even the texture of that apple skin is different, then also it may be an apple. Will happen with more and more training data. So the first and foremost important requirement required thing in machine learning is data. If you don't have a data, you can't apply any kind of machine learning algorithm on that. Fine, forget about any kind of application. So in whatever domain you want to work, you have a proper amount of data, then only machine can learn. Okay, if you have a not enough amount of data or the data quality is not good, make sure that your machine learning model will not be good. You cannot do proper classification, you cannot perform proper regression or any other thing. Any machine learning model you cannot have with a good accuracy. So thing is that data. Okay, the question is that as a beginner, how you will manage the data, okay, or where to get the data. Fine. At your level, you may not be knowing that how to get the data or what could be the potential applications of machine learning or from where to get the data. So let me show you a page for that. You can go to my website, maheshbhiwani.in. Okay, it will be a bit slow as I'm operating through hotspot. Here you will find one section called resources. Inside resources, there is a section called a notice board. Okay, I hope it is visible to everyone. Okay, you just go to this notice board. And within that notice board, you will find one section. Let me show you a particular section. Yeah, it is here. You see that in this particular webinar on building machine learning applications at RNG Patel Institute, Bardoli. that I have given the links for lots of different repository. Okay. So very popular UCI repository. Then there is another popular is called known as a Kaggle repository. So let me describe one out of this because it will be time consuming to discuss all. So let me show you only one of that. That is UCI library. Now many research labs are working behind generation of such kind of data for machine learning application. So you see that as of now, this website contains 588 different data sets for the research. It's freely available. You can download it in mostly CSV format. You can easily read it in Python and you can use them. And you can view all data. When you click on that, let me see, view, yeah. So you will get to see all 588 data sets, the name of the data set, what are different types of data available into the data set, whether it is for classification task or recommendation system, or whether it is for a regression problem. So native application for this particular data set is mentioned here. What are the different types of attribute, whether it contains only integer attributes or categorical attributes or float attributes, how many different instances of data sets data are available, right? As I said that whenever parent is only showing one apple, the child was not able to interpret the different shapes with the similar color, right? So tomato and ball, everything it was treating as an apple. You need amount of data to train your model. So that amount of data is nothing but this. So this data set is having a 4,177 instances to train and test your model. This data set contains 48,842 samples and so on. So that is this field. Number of attributes. So like if it is an apple, so I can have attributes like shape of the object, color of the object, the texture of the object. So that could be my different attributes. Fine. If I want to categorize different kind of cars, then what could be the attribute? Like what is the model, which company is manufacturing this, whether it is auto mode or not. Okay, so that could be the different attributes for that car. Right? If I want to measure that what would be the average of particular automobile, so I'll check out that what is the weight of this automobile, because that will affect the mileage per gallon. Okay, what is, when it was made, that is the production year, that is also important. Fine. What is the horsepower of the engine? How many cylinders it is having. So all these are called attribute which is affecting the prediction. And when this database was launched, that year is given here. Right? So that is the summary of this. On left hand side panel, as you can see that there are default tasks are given. If you want to perform classification, then there are 442 data sets are available. So out of this 588, 442 corresponds to classification. 137 data sets are used for regression. 117 data set you are clustering and so on. Similarly, attribute wise also data sets are given, data type wise also, area wise also. Suppose you want to explore the social sciences application. So data set for social sciences are there. There are 38 data sets are available. Got it? If then you should use less number of attributes. So we have 151 data sets having attributes less than 10. There are 256 data sets available having attributes between 10 to 100 and so on. Okay, so as number of attributes increases, the complexity of model will also increases. Right? This is number of training samples given into the data set. So this is wonderful application, I say website. You must go through this. You will get different, say for example, this is automobile. This must be measuring or predicting miles per gallon for given vehicle. So you can use this data set for some that kind of prediction. Okay, like breast cancer detection. So this is the medical field data set. So there might be lots of parameters would be given to breast cancer. Fine, and lots of research is going into this area nowadays. And you can actually use this data set to design your own algorithm to predict whether breast cancer is present or not, given some risks or statistics from the various reports. Fine. So you can go through this. So what I'm doing is I'm simply putting this link. Okay, instead of CI library, only one data, I'm putting the link of my website. You can go through this, and here you will find all possible repositories. Okay, this is every link having many number of data sets. So depending on, you can find out the data set from this. So I'm just putting it into the chat box. Interested candidates can copy this. Okay. Let me move ahead. So the problem, one problem solved, where to get the data set. Fine, it is clear now. You can get it from here. So test phase I have already discussed. There are two major applications of supervised machine learning. One is called classification. Classification means what? You are given the different data, you categorize into one of the category or one of the class. Assume that these are the negative samples. Grade indicates some negative samples, and this grade indicates some positive. So this is just a notation of the class. Okay, this is like given some size of tumor, we will say that this all brains are cancer, and the patient on this side are not having the cancer because the tumor size is quite small. Right? So this tumor size, there could be many more attributes, and depending upon those attributes, we have to design or we have to derive a distant boundary. This may be a straight line or a hyperplane, that depends upon the complexity of data, such that it will separate data of two different classes. Now see, if I draw this, let me call this line equation as y is equal to mx plus c. You are very much familiar with this equation, right? We can represent line using the equation y is equal to mx plus c, where m represents slope of the line and c represents intercept of the line. So by tuning the parameter m and c, I can get such line which is dividing my data into two parts. See what is happening whenever new point is coming for the test, whether that is having a tumor or not. So what I'll do is, this is my feature, that is tumor size. M and C I already know from the given data. Okay, so you already have some samples in which attribute is also given and the class label is also given. Fine. So this is label and we have here some attributes. So based on this, that we are predicting or we are finding what should be the optimal value of slope and the y-intercept, so that this line can divide it into two proper parts. In fact, there are infinite lines are possible, but we have to select one which will minimize the misclassification. So here this line is doing zero misclassification, right? Clearly it is separating these two data. Now suppose, this model is said that, assume that the tumor size is 3.2, whether that patient is having a cancer or not. So what we'll do is simply we will put this X to this equation. M is already known. We have calculated from this old data. C is put it into the equation. I'll get some value Y. So Y zero, maybe positive, maybe negative. If it is zero, what this value X, M, C satisfy the line equation. So point will be on the line. And whenever point is on the line, you cannot determine whether it belongs to class positive or negative. So you won't be able to determine whether a patient is having a tumor or not. Sorry, cancer or not. Fine. But if that value is greater than plus or greater than zero, it means it is a positive value, then that data point will be on one side of the line. If it is a negative, it will be on the other side of the line. So we can easily predict now that once we have known the equation of this line and some unknown data is coming to us, we can simply put it into the line equation. We can look at the sign of that line and we can easily predict whether it will be in positive class or in negative class. So this is called classification. Most of the problems in machine learning falls under the classification or regression task. Okay. So major of them are classification problem, like you are classifying whether given flower is rose or not, okay, whether the given animal is tiger or not. So all these are classification problems. The another very interesting problem is called regression problem. Now see, what is the regression difference between classification and regression? Both are called prediction problem. Remember, both are predicting something. Here, it is predicting the class of data, whether the given data belongs to positive class or negative class. Okay? Maybe the given person is a boy or girl, fine? Or maybe given email is a spam or non-spam. So all these are considered as a classification problem because we are putting it into fixed category. Whereas in case of regression, we are fitting the line to the data such that most of the data fall onto the line. So this line is again some y is equal to mx plus c kind of line we have. Fine. But the difference is that whenever I'll put some value of x,
it will give me some value of y corresponding to that. Fine. So now the value is any real number here. You see that. So whenever I am providing a temperature as an input to the boiler and I want to compute the pressure, then that pressure is having any real range. It could be 20.5, it could be 28.39, 31.645, maybe 52.85. So it can take any real value. Whereas in case of a classification, output is always fixed. Either it will be positive or it will be negative. Right? Either student will be pass or he will fail. Either any particular team will won the match or it will that win the match or that team will lose the match. Right? Class can be multiple. It may be 2 class, 3 class, 4 class. But the output is always discrete and fixed. Whereas in case of regression, output is a real number. Okay, it is real number, remember that. So if I provide different weather parameters, like what is the humidity, what is the temperature, what is the air pressure, fine. So based on that, if rain, so this rain can be any real number. This equation will predict that there will be a rain of 2.2 millimeter. Or it may be 6.5 millimeter, maybe 3.25 millimeter. So there is no fixed classes. Are you getting the difference between classification and regression? Fine. Again, classification will put your data into predefined fixed categories or classes, whereas regression predict any real number. So the output of classification will be categorical number, and output of regression will be any real number. Fine. That is the difference. In both the cases, we are using labeled data. Okay, remember that in both the cases, we required labeled data for the training. What it means? Data is also given and this label is also given. To predict the CPI of seventh semester, I want to predict your SPI for the current semester, seventh semester. So what I need to collect? The data which is affecting the SPI. Okay, or from which I can predict the SPI. So what I'll do is, I'll simply make a data set like it is showing me that. So I'll use the data of previous class. That means previous year. Okay, so I want to predict it. So I'll use some historical data. So I'll collect CPI of semester 1, CPI of semester 2, CPI of semester 3, how many hours of reading student was doing, what amount of time he was spending on social media, what type of book he was reading, whether he was regular in class or not. So all these parameters I'll collect for the previous year student, means your senior's data. And for that, I'll see that what was the SPI in seventh sem. Okay. So for this particular student, it was 7.3. For this, it was suppose 8.2. For him, it was 6.5. So this is called a label. I have label known to me. I have attributes for this particular instance. Okay. So suppose his SPI here, it was 8.2 in first semester. It was some 7.1 in second semester. Up to sixth semester, I'll collect the SPI. I'll also collect what amount of hour he was studying, maybe 3 hour. Fine. What kind of book he was referring. So on an average, he was referring 2 books for every subject and so on. So I know the attribute values. I also know that what was the SPI in seventh semester. It means I am having data as well as label both with me. Fine. So based on that, I will create a regression line, or I will create y is equal to m plus c kind of line. Now, I don't know what SPI you will get in seventh semester, but I want to predict. So what I'll do is I will collect the similar attributes of you. SPI from semester 1 to semester 6, number of hours you are spending for study, books you are using for this, that, whether you are regular or not, what amount of time you are spending for the social media. Okay. I don't know the answer. You see, I don't know what is the SPI of your seventh semester, but I already know the relationship between all these parameters and the SPI. So that's quite, if someone is getting consistently 8 SPI in semester 1 to 6, then there are higher chances that he will get 8 around SPI in seventh semester or next semester also. Fine. So based on that, we are creating this line. How to create it, we'll discuss later on. But this line is created. Now, I'm only providing this data to this line. Okay. So what this line will do, it will take all the variable, it will put it into the line, and it will find out that what will be the appropriate SPI for that particular person. So I can easily predict what will be the SPI in next semester of particular student. But again, this is just a prediction.
there might be some error in function. Okay, that's obviously there. You cannot have a classifier which can do 100% perfect prediction. Okay, but closely, that will rarely happen, that who is consistently getting a SPI 8, fine, and the model will predict SPI 2 for him. That will happen. It will predict very close to it. Suppose his model is predicting SPI 8.2 for any student. So in actual examination, that student might get 8.4 SPI, or he might get 8.2 or 8.0 also. Fine, but it will be close to what line has predicted. So the accuracy of model depends on the thing, how close it is predicting to the actual value, and whether it is a classification or whether it is a regression problem. Fine. Supervised learning method, as I explained you, that whenever we are doing the training, we required some data as well as label associated with that. So this is my training data, and I have label apple for this. Fine. So I will have label for all of these data, like this is horse. Apple to horse, I'm using different categories. Now, as I said, for a proper training, you required more data. So what I'm doing is, instead of just providing a single apple, I'm providing bunch of images of the apple, so that model will be more generalized and it will have a proper training that, okay, not only it should be red and round in shape, it could be green also, it could be something like a yellowish also, fine. So all this variability of the apple will be captured by this model. But it means you can compare it with to the baby. Okay, so if you are showing all these kind of apples to the baby, and every time you are saying that this is apple, this is apple, this is apple, it means this is a supervised kind of learning. Then you will show all these tomatoes to the baby, okay, different shape, different size, different color. And every time you are telling him that, beta, this is called a tomato, this is called a tomato. So that learning will become stronger and stronger. And next time, whenever you are showing him some fruit or vegetable, baby will be able to identify whether it's an apple or it is a tomato. Got it? That's what the philosophy of learning is. But the issue is that whenever I'm having an image data or very high dimensional data, I cannot use it directly to train the model, because model will be very, very complex. Assume that this image is of size 400 by 400. So how many pixels will be there? 4 × 4, that is 16. So there will be total 160,000 data into this one image. Yeah? 160,000 pixels are there into the image. And when you try to train the model with this amount of data, the model will be very, very complex and learning will be very, very slow. That's very obvious, I guess. There is no need of explaining this one. Fine. If I tell you that you have to remember 50,000 words from the dictionary, probably very hard or next to impossible for you. But I'll say that you have to remember only 10 words. Obviously, that will be easy for you. Fine. So if this training vector is small, then model can be trained properly. So what we need to do is, before we give this data straight away to training model, we need to first extract the feature from the data, and that feature should be given to the training model, to you, should be used for the training. Now, what this feature is? It is compact representation of your input data. So if this is an apple, then I'll apply some technique on that, and I'll come up with some 50 or 60 numbers here. Okay. So there are different feature extraction methods are there. A few are like LBP operator. Fine, you can use LTP operator, maybe Gabor wavelet. So there are many such different feature extraction techniques are available. You can apply on the this image or high dimensional data, and it will give you the compact representation of that. Okay. So even you have just 50 numbers to represent the apple, you can effectively represent it, all the images, fine, using just a 50 number. So the vector of this 50 number should be given for the training, and associated label, whether it is an apple or whether it is tomato or whether it is a horse, should be given. So now this training will be better, because model has to be trained with only 50 or 10 or 30 or 40 data instead of 1,000. I hope you are following me. So what could be the feature, or how to derive the feature? Again, as I said, that there are number of techniques are there, but still, if you are not able to understand what feature is, I have this slide for specifically for that. Suppose I want to classify whether given polygon is a concave or convex or rectangle or square or right angle triangle. Okay. So I have one mechanism, I have one hardware, which will give me the appropriate answer. So before it give me appropriate answer, it should be trained. And for training, I have to feed multiple samples of concave, multiple samples of convex, multiple samples of rectangle, and so on. And I have to provide the label with that so that this model will be trained properly. And whenever I'll give some shape to this, it will tell me whether it's a triangle or a square or rectangle and so on. Now see, there exist infinite different concave polygons. I hope you agree to me. There exist infinite convex polygon. Similarly, there exist infinite variations of all this. You cannot train your model with all of this. Fine. So what you can do is you can extract the features instead of using this particular shape, because this could be small in size, it could be very big in size. So it is difficult to train the model using directly straightforward shapes. So can anybody tell me what is the difference between concave and convex? Any one difference? There are many ways to interpret it, but what kind of polygons are called convex and what kind of polygons are called concave? Can you find any pattern into this? Let me know your answer in chat box. Yeah, I'm waiting for the answer here. How to differentiate concave polygon from the convex polygon, or which is the thing which will differentiate these two different classes or two different objects, concave and convex? Let me show you the diagram again. Probably you might get some hint. I'm moving back and let me see if any answer is popping here. No one is there. I'll wait for 20 seconds. Yeah, we can differentiate it by its shape. That is okay. By shape, we can know that, but how to check whether it is a convex or concave? Convex polygon has some edges inward direction. Yeah, that is one solution. Concave have four corner, convex has five corner. No, that is not proper. Bharat, that's wrong, because the polygon I have shown, he is just one example. There could be concave polygon with infinite or not infinite. Let me put it into realistic way. It can take any number of sides. I have shown only one with four sides for the simplicity, but it can take 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, any number of sides. But Rutal has given a correct answer, like convex polygon has some edges in inward direction. Or let me put it into another way, that if you observe at the angle carefully, then the angle between two consecutive pair of line is always greater than 180 degree, always less than 180 degree in case of concave. Whereas in convex, there exists at least one pair of edges such that the angle between that two will be definitely greater than 180 degree. Okay, so I can use that fact as a feature vector. Okay, so I don't need to store entire shape pixel by pixel. Rather, what I'll do is I'll extract the angle between two consecutive pair of lines. And I'll tell my model that if any one of them is greater than 180 degree, then this is a convex. And if it is all less than 180 degree, then consider it as a concave. Okay, so this is considered as a feature. You see, and I treat as a feature vector. Fine, that is the compact representation. And you see that even I'm representing it using four or five number, given the millions of different samples of convex, concave and convex polygon, I can easily separate out it just by looking at these four or five values, isn't it? If any one angle is greater than 180, definitely the convex. So I need to find out such a compact representation so that it is understandable, as well as it will differentiate object of one class from the other class. Okay, so I hope you are clear with feature. So let me help to find out the features of rectangle. Can anybody suggest me what could be the feature for rectangle? Or how I can differentiate rectangle from other shapes? Any idea? You can, yeah, Sri has given correct answer. Convex, all of its interior angle must be less than 180. Angles 90 degree. Every few are agree with this, or anyone would like to add? Every angle is equal. So both corresponds to same answer, but is it applicable or it requires some modification? Okay, let me give you the hint. This is not the universal definition of rectangle, because square is also having the same feature. All angles are 90 degree, or all angles are equal. And what I said, feature should be such that it will distinguish object from one class to another class. So what changes are required into the feature vector of rectangle from the square? I'm sure now we can do this. Redefine the feature vector for rectangle. Can I expect at least one answer? Yeah, exactly. Length and height of edges, fine. Or Prince has said that two opposite side of rectangle has same dimension. See, this is true for square also. The opposite sides are, let me read it again. Rectangle, the opposite sides are equal. So that is true for square also. And this often happens whenever we are extracting the features. Some of the features of one class will be definitely similar to some of the features with other class, but all features should not be identical. Remember, fine. All features should not be identical. There should be at least something which will separate out the object of one class from the other one. So the previous diagonal of rectangle bisects each other. That is true in case of square also, Ria. In square also, the diagonal will bisect to each other. Right? So let me show you this. So the previous answer from Professor Ruthal was correct, that when you look at the side, fine, you see that here the width is not equal to height. Height is not same as width. Otherwise, all the parameters are same. This all angles are 90 degree. Opposite sides are having equal length. That is also true. This is bisecting in this. Similarly, here diagonal are also bisecting. So avoid similar features and try to add the features which are distinctive. So you see that here it is 30, 50. This 4 represents angle. This 4 represents angle. So you see that this and this. So from this also we can infer that this is not concave polygon, or this is not a rectangle. Right? So now we have two possibility. Either this could be rectangle or it could be square. So what we need to do is we need to add some other features. So if h is equal to w, then it is square. Otherwise it is not. Is that clear? Similarly, I can define right angle triangle like this. At least one angle should be 90 degree, and addition of all three angle is 180 degree. Similarly, I can put the definition for equilateral triangle like angle of all the edges. All the angles are of equal degree. That is 60 degree. That is equilateral triangle, or a regular triangle. So the angle may not be same, and the summation of angle is again 180 degree. Okay, so by such kind of things, you can represent your object in compact way. That is called feature vector. And instead of providing the value of each pixel of triangle or square or rectangle, what I'll do is I'll use this feature vector to train. And next time, whenever I give this feature vector, so that model will tell me that whether it's a convex or concave or whatever it is. Let's come back to our original discussion. So this is what it is required. Given the high dimensional data, you extract the representative or the compact feature of that. Features will be used for training the model. Training the model means what? You have to find out mathematical equation for that. So one of that is like a line equation. As I said, y is equal to mx plus c, by which you can perform regression also, and you can also perform classification. Yeah, so now comes the testing part. So that was all about training. Now in case of a testing part, we only have a data. We don't know what is the label of this. As I said, that if I collect records of your up to 6th semester, I don't know what will be the SPI in 7th semester, fine. But this model is trained with the data of your seniors. So in that case, the semester SPI of 7th semester was known. So the relationship between this feature vector and the label is already known by this learned model, okay, or the trained model. So similarly, now when I get some images of input, I'll extract the feature of that image. And I'll use same feature extraction technique which I have used here. Okay, if I use their local binary pattern method, I cannot apply Gabor-Heel. Remember that. This both at both the places you have to use identical method to do this. These features will be given to this learned model. Now this model is already knowing the relationship between the features and the shape from the previous slide, right? So when we get to this learn model is also having the answer that if feature vector looks like this, then the answer should be 4. Or if features look like this, then SPI should be 8.5. If answer vector looks like this, it should be 9.2. And similarly, it will give us the prediction. So here in our case, it will give the answer as an apple. So see, this is how it prediction happens in industry. Here, fine. Let's move towards another learning that is called unsupervised machine learning. In case of supervised machine learning, the teacher was present and the label of data was also available. So it was easy to learn. But in this case, only data is available. Okay, teacher is not present and model has to learn by himself looking at the data. And model, what it does, instead of assigning the label, because label is not known, fine. So model cannot assign label to the data. Rather, it will create a group of similar looking objects. So based on to the characteristics of data, it will create some groups. So all these are cats. So it will create or it will identify that if object is looking like this, then I should put it into group A. Okay, now model is not knowing whether it's a dog, but depending upon similarity, it will create group one, group two, so on. And if image looks like this, then it will put it into the group two. Group two is what? Dog. Is that clear? Fine. Let me give the analogy of the child learning. Now, child is so many different objects or the toys around him. So now parents are not there and kid is playing. So what kid will try to do is he will try to pick up the similar objects and it will group them together. Like all the balls, he will put it into one corner. Fine. Then he will pick up different cars. He don't know whether it is known as a car or not. Okay, he will simply look at the object. If there are 3-4 cars are there in toys, then he will pick up all the similar looking objects, that is car, and it will put it into some another place. Then he will pick up 3-4 dolls, okay, and it will put it into some another corner. So that is what unsupervised learning. Depending upon to the similarity of the object, child will learn by himself. Nobody is there to tell him that this is ball, you should put into that corner. This is doll, you should put it into some separate place. But by looking at the characteristics of the object, child himself is learning that, okay, if shape is like this, it is a round, then it may be a ball, I should put it into that corner. Okay, if it is having a head, it is having the two hands and legs, it probably it's a baby or it's a doll, I should put it into this corner. So this is what unsupervised learning is, where the agent or this model is learning by himself. So now next time, once the model is learning, has learned, and when you provide some image as an input, so it will check that whether it is similar to group one data or it is similar to group two data. And based on that, it will give us the recommendation that it is close to this or it is close to this. This is what unsupervised learning is. And unsupervised learning is having also very good application in machine learning domain. The very popular one is called clustering. Okay, so basically what I have explained is called clustering, that we are grouping similar data, that is called a clustering. Now clustering is very, very helpful in business domain. Okay, let me give you the example. Like if you consider any superstores or e-commerce platform. So initially what was happening, whatever promotional scheme the store was launching, the information about that promotional scheme was sent to everybody. Okay, every customer. So if that store is having a record of 1,000 customer, then they will send the email to all 1,000 customers. Now probably out of that 1,000 customer, 50 may be male, 50% may be female. Again, based on age, if we consider, then 20% may be kids, some 50% may be adult, and 30% may be senior citizen. Got it? And assume that product which they are launching or for the product for which they are doing the advertisement, it may be a beauty product, fine? So if you send a beauty product message to kid, or if it is related to a beauty product which is related to female only, and if you are sending the mail to the email to the male customers or to the senior citizens or to the child, then there is no meaning of that, fine? Nobody is going to read it. So for example, let me give you the very common example. It's a Netflix. So everybody has an interest in different genres. Fine. Somebody may be interested in thriller movies. Somebody may be interested in only sci-fi movies. Somebody may be interested in horror movies. Somebody may be interested in comedy movie. Now, assume that you are interested in comedy movie. Some new movie, horror movie is launching. So if Netflix will blindly send the recommendations of horror movie to everyone, then probably you will skip using Netflix. Fine. You will get bored that I am not interested in such movie and Netflix is continuously pushing me the notifications regarding the horror movie. So better that I should switch to some other platform, isn't it? So customer segmentation is very, very important area of the clustering. So what it does, it will find out the similar kind of customers, maybe female of age between 20 to 40. And the beauty product related advertisement should be sent to them only. So the company or the store has to do less advertisement. That will result into less effort, less money, and ultimately they will get more benefit. And if it is a new toy, then advertisement should be sent to child. Are you getting? If it is something related electronic gadget, then the people in the age of 25 to 40 may be interested. So mail should go to them only. So that segmentation of the customer is quite, quite important to understand the business and to boost the business. So that is what clustering is. Another thing is anomaly detection. That means you have to find out some irrelevant pattern from the data. Okay, the one I have discussed was fraud transaction detection. Okay, so that is what anomaly detection or the outlier detection. I will discuss it in detail as we are running out of time and I have already explained it. Let me move ahead. So this is what we are doing is in unsupervised learning, we don't have a class label. So we are simply creating clustering. And in case of supervised learning, we know the labels. So we are trying to design a decision boundary such that all the data class will be on one side and all the data of another class will be on another side. Okay. So we are interested in creating decision boundary. And the third type is reinforcement learning. Reinforcement learning means it is something like a penalty and reward based method. So if you are doing something good, you will be rewarded. If you are doing something bad, you will be punished. Okay. So again, I'm taking the same analogy. When child is, just a second. When child is trying to learn like a ride a bicycle or he's trying to walk, okay, he's learning to walk. So what will happen when he's taking 2-3, then parents will be excited and they will clap. Okay, they will clap for the baby and say some words for the appreciation. That very good beta, fine. Or they may give claps or they may pat on the back of the baby. So baby will be get some motivation and he will again walk, try to walk or that baby will try to ride the bicycle. So you see that he has done some good thing. So he has reward. But if baby will fall, so that was not desirable. Okay, that action was not desirable. So what will be the punishment in that case? Probably parents will not appreciate it. Fine, they will not give him a clap or baby himself might get injured. So those are the rewards, punishment in that case or the penalty in that case. So learning is done by this approach is called reinforcement learning. Fine, that whenever you are doing good, some reward you will earn, and whenever you are doing some bad, some punishment will happen. Okay, and based on that, you are learning. So reinforcement learning is typically used in case of robotics. Okay, otherwise, we are not using it much. Probably this is the last slide of this presentation. So it's already 3. I'll quickly try to explain this. And this is actually heart of any machine learning model. See, how you have to train is whatever data set you have available. Assume that you have downloaded some data set from any given website. And it is having, say, for example, some 10,000 record or 1,000 record. Fine. So all you cannot use for the training because you have to test the performance of model also. Fine. Whether it is good or not. So we have to divide this data set into two parts. Some of the data we have to keep for test the model. So assume that 30% data I'm using for the testing. Rest of the 70% data I have here. Now from this 70% data, again, I'm using some 80% data for a training purpose. 20% data for the validation. Okay, so the 70 is divided into two parts, 80% plus 20%, so totally 100. Now see, using this 80% data, I should create a model. So that may be linear regression, logistic regression, neural network, SVM, it can be any machine learning model. once this model is created, I will test the model using this validation set. It means this data were not used during the training. Okay, this is unknown data for the model, and I'll check whether this model is giving correct answer to me or not. Okay, so whenever I'm using 10 shapes or 10 images of apple for a training, and here I'm having a 3 other images of apple. So if my model is correctly identifying all these 3 apple, what it means that my model is properly generalized. Okay, it is performing good on the data which was not used for the training purpose. So if you are happy with your model, then fine. If you think that model is not performing good, then you need to readjust the parameter of the model. Okay, it means you change your algorithm or tune the parameters of the machine learning model, and again create a modified version of this model, and again you test the accuracy of that model using the validation set. If you are happy with that model, then fine. If not, then again go to this cycle until you get the appropriate model. Once you got the model, now you can use it for the actual testing. So during the actual testing, this test set you have to give here, and you have to find out that what is the accuracy of model, right? And this accuracy is considered as the final accuracy of the model. If it is above 95, 97, then it is fine. Okay, depending upon application, somewhere even 99% accuracy is not acceptable, while in some cases 92 is good enough. Fine, so depend upon your application. But this is how we can create a model. If you are happy with this model, you can deploy it into the hardware and you can use it into the real world. And if you are not, again, go back and do something other. Okay, you can try some other model, or you can do some pre-processing, or you can tune the parameters. Fine. So how much time do I have? Coordinator, may I know how much time can I take?
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
Yes, Rutal, you are audible. How much time can I take?
Sir, it's fine. You can explain your topic as much as time you want.
Okay, fine. Probably this is the last slide, so let me discuss it very quickly. Fine. So now for every question, I expect answer from audience. Fine. So you can write down your answers into the chat box. You just have to tell me whether given problem falls under classification category, regression category, or clustering category. And I hope that I have made the points clear what classification is, what regression is, and what clustering is. Let me means you have to predict some categorical variable, or the output is fixed. Regression means you are predicting some real number, fine. And clustering means you are clustering your data based on the similarity or the characteristics. So your first question is predict price of house based on its size, bed, number of floor, population, construction year, etc. You just write down into the chat box whether it is a classification problem, regression problem, or clustering problem. Exactly, fine, it is a regression problem. Why? Because we are predicting the price, and this price could be any real number. It may be 35 lakh, it may be 36.24 lakh, maybe 25, yeah. Most of you got right, it is a regression problem, fine. Next one, predicting tumor cell as a benign or malignant. So these are the types of cancer. Benign means no cancer or the initial stage, and malignant means it's a dangerous. So what is the type of this problem? Whether it's a classification problem, regression, or clustering. Yeah, exactly. Fine. Hinal, Harsh, all are correct. It's a classification problem because you see that the output is fixed now. Given the data, it could either be benign or it could be malignant. There is no other possibility of the answer. So this is called classification. Google News. So Google News typically categorize the different news documents. So what is the type of this problem? Categorizing news. Yeah, it is clustering, fine. Almost everyone are right. It's a clustering because it will create a cluster of similar articles and it will show you. So whenever you are reading some article related to cricket, you will get the similar articles at the bottom side. And if you are reading some political news, then you will get all the political related news. So exactly, this is a clustering problem. Identifying credit card transaction is legitimate or fraudulent. classification. Yeah, classification, fine. So all of you are through to this concept. Fine, it is a classification because there are only two possibility that either it could be legitimate or fraudulent. So we have a fixed categorical labels to this. Predicting the rain on 31st June 2020. So what amount of rain would be on this particular day? That's what I'm interested in. Yeah, it's a regression problem. Because this rain could be anything, maybe 3.5 mm or maybe 6.5 mm, 2.35 mm. So it's a regression problem because we are predicting real number. Good, good. Good number of answers I'm getting. Separating emails in primary social promotion and updates as we see in the Google Gmail. Separating emails, classification, clustering. So you can look at this problem in both the way. Fine, it is a classification problem. You can solve it using classification also as well as clustering also. Fine, because we can club it into one group based on the similarity, or we can look at the other perspective, like we have fixed number of classes and we can perform classification also. So both answers are right. Group boys and girls based on their characteristics. Group, create groups of boys and girls based on the characteristics. Classification is a wrong answer. Clustering is the right answer. Right? So Srey is correct, Prince is correct. Fine, because we are grouping it based on the similarity. Right now we do not have a fixed class. Okay, if we want to see whether given person is a boy or girl, then it is a classification. But right now what we are doing is depending upon the characteristics of the person, fine, we are putting it into some groups. That's why it is a clustering. Otherwise, it would be a classification problem. Predicting SPI in next semester based on your IQ, classes attended, study hours, etc. Yeah, regression. Fine, very nice. All of you got it. Fine. So at least I hope that you understood what are the different types of problem. Fine, or which problem falls under which category. And we have different types of algorithm for solving all of this. See, if it is a classification problem, then we have a k-nearest algorithm, logistic regression, artificial neural network, support vector machine, discriminant analysis, decision tree, and many more different algorithm exist for this. Similarly, for regression, we have a big list of regressors. And for clustering also, we have a big list of algorithms. Fine. So you know that my problem is regression, you can choose any one of these. If you know that your problem is classification, you can choose any one of these. Fine. So depending upon your domain of the problem, you can choose one of the algorithm out of this. So let me quickly summarize the session that we have started with different applications and the different types of learning like AI, machine learning, deep learning. So we have seen the relationship between all type of this learning. Then we have discussed where classical approach will fail and where machine learning will come into the picture or what exactly happening into the machine learning. And we have discussed various types of machine learning techniques. Let me recap it. Supervised, unsupervised, reinforcement learning. Under supervised learning, we have a classification and regression. In unsupervised learning, we have a clustering and anomaly detection, also association mining. And reinforcement learning, we are using it for robot navigation and all. And finally, we have seen that how any model could be built. So now this is very generalized model, okay, model building. So this model could be classification model, maybe regression model, fine, maybe clustering model. So whatever list of algorithms I have shown on previous slide, all you can apply here, fine, and you can create appropriate model. So that's all from my side. We can have a question and answer session now. So if you have any query, either you can unmute yourself or you can type your question into the chat box.
Thank you so much, sir, for this amazing session. Actually, we learned a lot in this introduction only. Now, I hope student will put their questions right now. Actually, I got so many questions in the registration, during registration itself. Students, please put forward your questions to the sir so that he can answer.
Okay, before I answer your question, I'll take 1 minute, just 1 minute to talk about one more resource. As I said that from this particular page, you will get a lot of learning resources. Fine. You go to any different section and learning resources are available for each and everyone. I have kept here some logistic regression, although I could not cover up that, but I have planned it. So I have kept some learning resources for that. And some nice blogs are available on machine learning if you would like to explore. Apart from that, I have started one YouTube channel that is called Code Crux. Fine, so you can follow me on this. Right now I have uploaded the fuzzy logic, a playlist on fuzzy logic. You can find videos on this fuzzy logic concept. And right now I'm designing a course on machine learning itself. So in very near future, you will find the course on machine learning here. So it would be fine if you are interested, you can subscribe the channel and you will get the notification for the same. Right? So right now I have entire list of fuzzy logic videos, and in future, I expect you to scroll the machine learning playlist as well. So that's all. And Rukal, you have already sent me a few questions. So let me first clear it. Then we'll take a few more questions if it is possible. Right? So the first question was, what is the future of the data science?
Okay,
as I said that, no industry can survive without data science nowadays. Each and every industry is using data science in one or another way. And just looking at the applications I have discussed, you can see that where you can apply the data science. You can apply that concept almost everywhere. So the future is quite bright, and many universities are offering courses on data science, specifically on data science as well as on machine learning. So make sure that the future of data science is quite bright. The second question is, what are the scopes in which data science is useful? So I have already explained few applications. So I hope that the first half is answered. Is data science better than Java or for a good job? As of now, I can say definitely yes. Okay, it has a better market compared to Java. Because with Java, you can do some traditional work only, but no business will survive without this analysis and all part in future. So that's obviously yes. Different IND of technologies used in data science. IND, I could not understand. What is this IND? Different IND of technologies used in data science. Okay, it may be kind. Okay, different kind of technologies used in data science. So technology, I mean, you are asking, I understood that you are asking for the tools, fine. So probably Python is one of the most powerful language for the data science. Apart from that, MATLAB is there, R programming language is there, okay, which is very good for statistical analysis. And there is a RapidMiner tool is also available. But I can confidently say that Python is at number one. Okay, you can choose that technology. Why Python language is suggesting to the beginner to start their programming language? Python language being start to the programming language. No, it is not like that. Most of the times, learner is suggested to learn C programming language, not the Python programming language. Right? Because C is very easy to understand. It is high level language. And once you develop your concepts in C, you can develop your concepts for any other programming language. Yeah, for the learner or beginner of the machine learning, you should choose Python, definitely. Fine, because Python is having a very rich collection of libraries, and it is having a very powerful functions for processing your data. It means you do not have to write basic code for processing your data. You just call the function, your job is done. So you can focus on the core concepts rather than writing the basics. That's why Python is very good. Scope. Learning in Surat, it's really not that much. Because in Surat, industries are very local industries. They are very in size, and probably they may not be using much analytic that. Right? So I don't see the scope of machine learning in as of now, maybe in future. Either to choose ML or DS for master, if I want to go Canada for my master. Now see, ML is kind of part of data science. Okay, you can consider that. For data science, you have to learn a lot of things. So machine learning is part of that. So whatever it is, university is offering, whether data or machine learning. Fine. Because if two universities are what happened? Maybe might be due to. Let me see if I can share it. Share the screen. Just a second. Activity was not going on, so probably. Join now. Just a moment. I'm disconnected. Anyway, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Fine. Yeah, good. Yeah. So what I was telling is that most of the research which is old is coming to India. Fine. And we are looking at it that it's quite new. But it is quite already done in some other countries. So in USA, it's quite a good hub for machine learning. Lots of people and lots of groups are doing a good amount of research work in this field. What we have to actually do in ML's industrial job. So your job may be like mostly programmer based, fine, or you have to do the data analysis, or you have to build the model for doing something. So that depend on which domain you are going. Suppose you are going to the banking and you are doing some machine learning application, then probably you might have to predict the flow of customer, or you might have to predict whether that what kind of scheme we can launch to what kind of people. Okay, so that kind of data analysis you might have to do in banking sector. So that vary from sector to sector, and I cannot discuss all the sectors here, but that's what you have to design the model. That's common for all. Future in ML is obviously good. How to combine ML, deep learning and AI. So until and unless you go deep in this, you cannot understand, even if I explain. Fine, so for you to understand what ML is, how it works, and then only go to the deep learning. But all you apply machine learning model in hardware like robot and all. So if you are familiar with that assembly level language, where we are writing the code in chip, fine. That we are writing into that 8085 microchip or 8086 chip. Similarly, you can import or you can export your code from Python kind of chips and robot could work. Machine learning, IoT, you can say that IoT is purely machine learning based concept. Okay, you have to use that because IoT is ultimately capturing and generating lots of data, and we have to do analysis of that. So machine learning is the best way to do the analysis. Right? So you can consider that IoT and machine learning goes hand in hand. So these questions I have done. Let me see if I have any query in this. Sir, is this best field to go in data science in future or not? Yes, absolutely, you should go for this. No second thought about it. Any other question?
Sir, one more question. Rhythm has also posted that. That was, I think, earlier he has posted before you got disconnected. How ML is used in jobs or industrial level?
Can you repeat, please, how it can be used for?
I'm just reposting on behalf of Rhythm. How ML is used in jobs, industrial level?
ML, like as I said, that it depends on which sector you are working. Suppose one example I have already given. Suppose you are in banking sector, then your role as a machine learning engineer will be to build a model which will get more and more revenue to the banks. That means you can design a model which can find out the customers specific to particular scheme. Fine. So you do the analysis of older transaction, and from that you can find out the pattern that, okay, the customer from this particular region are interested in, say, for example, SIP, or the customer of this particular age group are interested in, say, for example, FD. So based on that kind of analysis, you can find out different group of customers, and you can launch different schemes for that. And there are higher chances that your bank will get a better prospectus out of that. Fine. Or suppose you are going into some other industry, say for example, automobile industry. So in automobile industry, probably suppose you are working for the automatic car, okay, auto gear car. So your job would be to automize the car based on to all the previous experiences, like if speed of car was like this, the rotation, like it was going straight or it was turning by some 10 or 20 degree, what was the amount of traffic around it, fine. So what should be the action taken by the car? So based on those historical data, you should build the model such that it will guide the car in a proper way. So all the applications which I have listed, you can consider that, you can assume that what will be your role in that. Fine, like suppose you are working in the some speech recognition domain. So for example, Alexa. Fine, so what will be your role is to identify the different pronunciation. You have to create a model such it can easily identify pronunciations of the people and it can find out appropriate search from the YouTube or any other well resources. Got it? So that totally depends on what kind of domain you are working. Am I clear?
I hope Ridham and everybody has got their answer to that question.
Fine. So again, I'm posting the link if somebody has lost it because I was this. So, okay, it is already disconnected. Let me, yeah, I'm connected here. So one is, and the another one is, yeah, I'll post it this one only. So you can subscribe it. Tutorials on machine learning in the future. So I'm right now preparing the videos on machine learning, so you can get the benefit of entire course now instead of just one session. So still, if anybody is having any query, I am open to that. Else we can conclude the session.
Okay, I think most of the questions, sir, you have answered very nicely. I hope all the participants got the answer to that question. Not only the just introduction to the machine learning you explained very well, but you just did the very nice answer, give the very nice answers to all the questions. So thank you so much for that, sir, to go into that this much detail for each and every question as well as all the topics in the machine learning. Now I request all the participants to, I'm posting the feedback form, just fill up this feedback form, and along with that I'm posting the link to that quiz also that you're supposed to complete today only. Thank you once again. Thank you so much, sir, for being with us. Now I request all of you just to turn on the camera. We will take one picture just as a memory. So please turn on your cameras. Dear participants, please turn on your cameras. We will have some photographs just as a memory of this expert talk. Sir, could you please stop sharing the presentation? We will have.
Sure. It's from left. Yeah. And, yeah.
Participants, please turn on your cameras. It was, sir, really a very nice session. We are hoping to see you one more time in the detail. I hope the students also feel the same. Please do not forget to write your feedback, dear students. And also attend that quiz also, which is based on this session. Okay. Okay, thank you so much, everyone. We are.
Thank you all. See you. Bye-bye.